Hello, dolls. Welcome back to the dollhouse. Today, I have been inspired to tell one of the stories about a time when I was physically attacked for being myself by someone who was jealous. The only thing that I can surmise is that this girl was jealous because we'd never had any beef. We'd never had any weird conversations. We'd known each other since like the sixth grade. We, you know, were always cool, always cordial. Yeah, we were actually pretty close in middle school. And one day in high school, it was junior year, I was walking down the hallway and she was standing with a group of other girls. Like, you know, we were cool, but we didn't really hang out. So I just would usually kind of speak to them and just keep it pushing. I was walking down the high school. I think I was wearing my cheerleading uniform. And she started singing a song. If you're burning and you know it, clap your hands. Like, I was like, who? What is that about? I just kept going because I didn't know what they were talking about. She started singing. And all the other girls started joining in, like, laughing. If you're burning and you know it, clap your hands. What she was trying to allude to was someone burning, as in having a sexually transmitted disease or a sexually transmitted infection, STI. So, anyway, I didn't really think anything about it because I definitely wasn't burning. So, you know, as time progresses, I had to run for political office again. Of course, you know, I've always loved politics. It was time for me to run for senior class president. Now, I went to a predominantly white school. It was maybe 25% ethnically diverse. I'm not going to say black. I will say, you know, Hispanic, black, Asian. Maybe made up 25% of the school. 75%, of course, was white. But we were all really cool. So I was a junior class president. When it was time for me to run for senior class president, when I get up to the podium, this girl starts to boo me. And her friends all join in. They booed me as I begin to deliver the speech about why I would make a good class president. Of course, my opponent got up there. She was a friend of mine, which I like. You know, she was also a woman who was a young lady, you know, young girl who was a descendant of the American enslaved, lighter skinned girl. She definitely was well liked too. So she got cheers. She ended up winning the presidency, which was probably a good thing because by the time senior year rolled around, I was burnt out. Kind of like Regina George, okay? So anyhow, we move into the next year because that was getting close to the end of the year. I didn't get elected, but, you know, I was pom-pom captain. I had so many other things on my plate, multiple winner of multiple scholarships. And one day after a basketball game, I had a real big altercation with this girl. She just kind of let things simmer under the surface. And I would see her and she would kind of look funny. And after a certain point, I wasn't about to speak to her. I didn't have to, honey. There were too many other people and too many other things to do. So later on down the line in the school year, things really blew up. This is senior year. I was hanging out with a group of girls. We were the popular girls. And my two friends, they were in like these wild love triangles with these two cousins who were both basketball stars. One was at our school. Oh, well, both of them had guys at our school. And then they had a cousin who was so fine. He had a crush on me. But I was such an awkward girl. I was definitely raised in church and I didn't know how to do anything with him other than sit there and look awkward whenever we had a chance to hang out. So we didn't hang out often. We hung out maybe like twice. Anyhow, my two friends, mischief makers they were, they decided that they were going to have it out with the other two girls that they were in the love triangles with. The other two girls were best friends. So they agreed that they were going to meet up and fight. Just get together and just box each other over these guys. This is what being male-centered and just lusting for male attention reduces women to. Boxing. Let me tell you where they decided to host this meetup. In the middle of a cemetery, in the dead of winter. Now, we live in a state that borders Canada, and I'm just going to leave it at that. Winter time, baby. This is basketball season. Like, this had to be late December. This was right before Christmas break. So these girls, they decide that they're going to, you know, fight these other two girls for their men, you know, because enough is enough. They're like been going back and forth with each other, talking trash and stuff. So anyway, after a basketball game, we all get up in each other's cars and we head out to the cemetery. This is high school. So we get out to the cemetery and they have their fights. My two friends, they fight these girls and it's the dead of winter. So, you know, they have their little squabbles and then things get, you know, squashed. So they let things go after that. So we're all just standing there. I guess the energy was tense. I was kind of oblivious. But the girl who started the booze for me and the girl who started the if you're happy and you know it, kind of stepped in my direction. Now, I'll describe her to you. She was probably about 5'10". I don't know if I mentioned this, but just beautiful, very dark, deep dark, like as close to mahogany as you can get. Perfect skin. She was a bigger girl, though. She was probably, at that time in high school, at 5'10", she was probably like 250 pounds, like a hefty weight. I was about 130 pounds with a cheerleading skirt on in January in the cemetery. So she walks in my direction, and she kind of pushes me with her shoulder. Now, one thing I am not is a punk, though. I'm little. I'm not that big. But I have six brothers and was raised in a family of wrestlers. Like, I would box them all the time. So I wasn't just about to let her roll up on me and, like, just do me like that. So I was just like, what is it? What's your problem? Her name is, I'm not even going to say what, but it's, like, very stereotypical Negro. Her mom named her after a Mexican town. I'm just going to leave it at that. So we will call her Tequila. So Tequila walks up and kind of nudges me in my shoulder and like move out the way. And I was like, no, you go around me. You go around me. And so she was like, I was trying to kind of get hype. And so I knew she wanted to fight. So I just started punching. And it seemed like we were out there in the cemetery rolling around. It seemed like forever. Because, you know, a fight is a struggle. It seemed like at least 10 minutes. And to the point where I definitely wanted to just quit. She got the best of me that day. I believe. I don't really know. But because I wasn't, you know, just going out without some struggle. She got hurt. But I think she definitely, like, pinned me down with her weight. And there was a point when I pinned her down. It was just a wild time. I was very athletic, obviously, and she was a couch potato. So that probably had something to do with it. But she was big. So anyway, we were out there sliding around on this thick ice in the dead of winter for no reason. For some animosity that she had against me, pretty girl beef. Like, raise your hand if you've ever been attacked for being the pretty girl. And I guess I'm black identified, if that's the term. Like, I'm more culturally identified with my enslaved, formerly enslaved culture, the black culture, you know, jazz, hip hop, you know, all that. Soul Train, you know. So there's something that is unspoken where if you are the pretty girl, the light-skinned girl, you have to at some point expect to be tried. And you have to defend yourself or else you will get run over. And so she tried me that day. We fought. She never tried me again. She never tried me again. And as a matter of fact, we got back to school and somehow our vice principal had learned about what happened. He was a black guy. He was probably early 40s. You know, he really had a passion for school, the kids. He called us into his office and he was just like, what happened? I don't expect that from you two. And I read her for filth. Not because he was there, but I was looking directly in her eyes. We were sitting next to each other. And I told her, you know, there's no reason for you to have had this animosity toward me. You only were this way because you must be jealous. Like, I've never done anything to you. And so she couldn't do anything. She couldn't say anything. She just looked sad because she knew that she did that for a reason that wasn't justified. And I saw the pain in her eyes from her feeling the shame of being seen as jealous and like she was less than. And she really, if she had only known herself, the overweight part she could have done something about. Now that wet sock personality that she had, that was on her. That's something that she could have done something about. But we all make choices. But as far as, you know, physical beauty, she didn't see herself. And she was overweight. Don't get it twisted. So that was a big part of it. But, you know, that's something that can be fixed. Had she done that, with her being almost 5'10", who knows where her pretty face self could have been. Because she was very pretty and had beautiful skin. And she had maybe like 3B type hair. But because it was always so greasy, I don't think it ever really had a chance to grow. I'm not going to say 3B. I was definitely like 3C, you know. So it wasn't like she was just, maybe she was jealous of the length that I had. But she just didn't see her own potential. And she, since she learned her lesson that day, interestingly enough, like when graduation rolled around, you know, the few black graduates, you know, in our class, there was a good number of graduates in our class, like maybe 300 or 400 people. And so the ones who were the black kids, I guess if we're going to keep saying black, I'm trying to switch it over to descendants of the American enslaved, because black is just so like, nothing against it. It's just like blah. So anyway, all of the descendants of the American enslaved and whatever mixture percentage, we all kind of took a picture together and she was looking at me and I looked over at her and we just kind of like went over to each other and gave each other a big cry, teary-eyed hug. And now we're friends on Facebook. I mean, that's high school for you, but that's just a story about having to defend yourself as the pretty girl. Sometimes you will be challenged, and there are many reasons why a person might be challenged for any reason, but for your looks and for your feminine energy and for your popularity, sometimes it seems like you're a special kind of target for women and men. Because the women, they're jealous because you are a threat to them. And then the men, they're jealous because you get something that they cannot get, which is attention and access. So, ladies, y'all be careful out here. Watch your back. I say carry a firearm because this, oh my God, this is not even the first or only time. And maybe I'll tell more stories because something happened maybe a couple years ago, not too long ago, as a grown adult, fully grown taxpaying citizen, a very, very deeply skin tone daughter of the American enslaved, picked up a mallet. Like, we were at a debate. She picked it up like as if she was going to hit me. What? Like, do I look like I lose decorum like that? You know, but you can really inspire rage in women when they feel challenged. So be careful. And as I say, carry a firearm, honey, because you never know. And, you know, I really appreciate y'all for listening to my story. Otherwise, please tell me about any of your stories where maybe you got attacked. And you can email me at exoticaldollhouse@gmail.com. I'd love to hear more of these types of stories so that we can be prepared and really let our younger MLS women know. I have nieces who maybe have about 30% mixture of the ancestry of the American enslaved. The rest of it is straight European. So they very much, they have that soul because they've got this ghetto black family on my side, but they have very much, you know, they've got a dilemma and they will have to defend themselves, and I will be there to fight for them tooth and nail. But they need to know what we know, which is be prepared to stand up for yourself and do not get too shy because you feel diminished. Don't feel ashamed about aligning yourself with authorities and protective figures who can watch over you. We've really got to prepare them to protect themselves. So I hope this was helpful. Shoot me an email, exoticaldollhouse@gmail.com. And I look forward to hearing your stories.